Hey, everybody. It's Jeff here from J&J. I've got a fantastic guided listening for you on one of the most important jazz records of all time, Dave Brubeck, Time Out, and his fantastic composition, Blue Rondo a la Turk. And I want to let you know, I want to invite you to take the 30-day free trial of JazzWire. I know many of you, hundreds of you from around the world, are working inside JazzWire. For those of you that are putting it off, for those of you that think JazzWire is just like every other jazz education thing out there where we send you a bunch of PDFs, it ain't that at all. Take the 30-day free trial and see exactly what is going on and why people that come and stay for a couple months end up staying for a couple years because they start getting good. All right. So this tune is from the 1959 album. I had to go to Wikipedia here. And, you know, I know you probably have Wikipedia too on your computer. It's not just my computer. But yeah, 1959, you know, kind of amazing thinking about everything that was going on in the jazz world, you know, the reverberations of John Coltrane and Charlie Parker and everything that was going on with Blue Note and just what an amazing album this was. It was the first jazz album to ever sell a million copies. Dave Brubeck on piano, of course, Paul Desmond on alto sax, Gene Wright on the bass, Joe Morello on drums. And this tune, and the whole album was pretty fascinating because it was odd time signatures, right? And this song, Blue Rondo a la Turk, is pretty well in 9-8 a lot of the time. 9-8 meaning three beats with three eighth notes in each. 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3. So in any 9-8 that you've ever listened to or played, 9-8 is group 3-3-3. 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3. So it's sort of a three feel, with the subdivisions being triple. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Cool. So turns out that other cultures in the world, our culture too, when I say our, like I'm speaking on behalf of everybody, but that's the way we think about nine. But there's so many ways to divide up nine. You could divide nine, you know, by nine. You could have one. Right? 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. That's a different feel than 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So how about twos? 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Well, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. And then we have a leftover. So we start doing this interesting arithmetic. So Dave Brubeck divided 9 by 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Ah, adds up to 9. And so this was a, you know, the story is that he was on a, I can't remember, Department of Defense or some sort of tour, and he's in Turkey and listening to some street musicians, and they're using this rhythm that's, you know, actually quite a, you know, standard, I don't know if simple is the right word, rhythm from that culture and from the Balkans and, you know, so many places in that part of the world use these, what we would call interesting, weird, hard time signatures. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. That's not how most of us would think to divide up nine beats, right? That's that Eurocentric, Western music-centric view that we still have. So that's part of what's going on here. So then there's this cool shift that happens in the middle of the song to the solos, where we're going from 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4. And so it goes that every group of three eighth notes now becomes a group of two eighth notes. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1. The pulse stays the same, but the subdivision changes, which means the groove totally changes. We call that a metric modulation. The way we can modulate from this key to that key, we can modulate from this time signature to that time signature. There's so much going on inside this thing. I'm sure many of you have heard it before, but I'm going to try to call some attention to things that are going on. One thing I'll tell you right out of the gate, the drums are not swinging. Dang, dang, dang. The bass is not walking a bass part. It's supporting this interesting time signature. Enough of Jeff talking. Let's listen to some music. It is 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. It's a four-measure pattern. And then 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. The fourth measure does the standard subdivision. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So listen to the bass. The bass is really pounding out the rhythm, you know, the underlying rhythm. Paul Desmond, that incredible sound of his. Little mistake or two there. And I love that they leave it. And the pedal tones, right? Boom, 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 boom. And the piano and the bass, very interesting part of the music. And the drums, the cymbal, is very much staying with that rhythm. Really quite straightforward when you know what the rhythm is. And it's still staying with that pattern. Is our first little metric modulation. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. That's the more standard. And check this out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Pretty slick, right? So how he transitioned to this simple American blues from that crazy Turkish stuff and found a way to kind of combine them. So now we are in the blues, right? What's the piano doing? Getting a cigarette and a drink, probably. There is no comping. Bass, drums, saxophone. Listen to the snare drum and the bass drum. Ah, finally a snare hit. Basically nothing. Listen to the bass. Just driving quarter notes. Little skip there. But not overly embellished. These dudes are just swinging in the simplest but deepest possible way. So interesting. Paul Desmond started his solo single time. Lots of eighth notes. Further into his solo now, four or five choruses, double time. Da-ba-do-ba-do-ba-da-ba-da, 16th notes. Bass and the drums are just creating this cushion for him to play over. It's fantastic. Towards the end of his life, Charlie Parker was asked who he liked on the scene, what alto sax players he liked. And his answer was Paul Desmond, which surprised the hell out of the interviewer. They thought that he would like a New York, you know, fiery, burning bebop player. And they said, you know, Paul Desmond, what's up with that? And he's like, he sounds like himself. Everybody else sounds like me. Fascinating, right? Bird knew what was what. So, Dave Brubeck. And so we're hearing a little more from Joe Morello on the drums, right? So we're kind of building somewhere here. More interactive, more of the snare drum and the bass drum, which we just frankly didn't hear in the sax solo. Great, you know, nice block chords that we would associate with Paul Desmond with Brubeck, but with maybe Red Garland, with George Shearing, the great playing. Kind of big band like, right? And it has a lot of energy and density, which makes sense. Joe Morello is wanting to support that. Ah, so it's bringing it down. So he's gonna end his solo probably, right? Oh, he's gonna end it right here. And he doesn't. That is so fascinating. It's so clear that he's ending his solo. But then he goes into this really sparse chorus. Motivic. really interesting. What a slick, cool thing to do. So what comes next? Saxo. And here we go. Ah, nice. So this, again, this transition, this reminder of this great 9/8 stuff. So a chorus of blues. And now, okay, so we're out of the blues. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1 kind of orchestral, right? I mean, we can see and imagine the timpani and everything going here. And we can hear the sticks at the end there, too. That's kind of slick. Holy cow. I remember the first, I don't know how many times I heard that. It just was impenetrable, right? I mean, it was cool. It was killing. It was awesome. Every once in a while, I felt like I could feel what was going on, and then it would escape me again, right? What a great, important album. And I mean, so many great, important albums. But this idea of messing with time and subdivisions. Dave Brubeck, you know, I didn't read all, you know, there's a lot of reading I could do about Dave Brubeck. I want to say he studied composition with Nadia Boulanger, a very important 20th century composer. So, I mean, he was, you know, one of the most important, super famous jazz musicians of all time, but he really had his head in the classical music too, and in music from other cultures. So, you know, fascinating album, Time Out. And this one especially is great. I first got to know this this recording from Al Jarreau. He wrote some really hip lyrics to it and did a great recording of it. Do you hear that? That's Boomer the Dog. It's not 9/8. I think it's a little more through composed, but you can tell the intensity, right? Yeah, okay. So I'm gonna leave you with Dave Brubeck, and I would love for you to listen to that tune a little bit more and see if you can follow the pulse that goes through the tune. And that right there is a really big deal. Now you know something about the rules of the song. It's like trying to watch a sporting event, football or cricket or rugby or whatever, and you can get into the energy and the intensity, but if you don't know what's in or what's out, or can I run that way, or do I always have to go that way, you can't really appreciate the game, right? So the more you know about the game, the more you appreciate it, the more you know about what's going on with these great recordings, the more and you can appreciate it, and the deeper you get, right? So I hope you have a great time with this. Listen to it some more. And I want to see you inside Jazz Wire. Check out the 30-day free trial. I tell you what, write me. You can make it 90 days too. And find out what's happening behind the paywall, and find out why so many people are getting so good with the approach that we have on the platform. I'll see you there.